Japan continues to create new electrical and electronic goods at an astonishing pace. One example is a fridge that boosts the vitamin content of vegetables. And this washing machine even does the ironing. Coming in a wide range of models and delivering high levels of reliability and performance, Japanese appliances are well known around the world. Recent years have seen the mushrooming of mass merchandise stores, offering vast selections of home appliances at low prices. These huge shops even draw tourists from other countries. It was after the Second World War that electrical appliances found their way into Japanese homes. Japanese manufacturers improved on foreign-made electrical goods to capture markets, first in Japan and then around the world. The industry developed a steady stream of breakthrough products that helped to expand Japan's economy. In Japan, the history of appliances is also the history of Japan's post-war economic revival. On this edition of Begin Japanology, we look at home appliances, how past generations of products powered Japanese economic growth, and also the trends visible in the latest models.
Hello and welcome to Begin Japanology. I'm Peter Barrican. Our theme for today is home appliances. I'm in Shinjuku, which is one of Tokyo's fiercest battlegrounds of appliance retailing, with over 20 large stores within just a few minutes' walk of Shinjuku Station, each giving an enormous selection of goods. This kind of concentration of rival shops, of course, makes for heated, fierce competition, and lots of people come long distances to Shinjuku to pick up appliances at bargain prices. Let's get started by exploring a brand new megastore to see what Japanese appliances are like and how they're sold.
Every day, people come in droves to Shinjuku to buy home appliances. I came in from the suburbs today. We've had our washing machine for about 10 years, and with all the new models that have come out since then, I wanted to see what's available. Let's tag along with these women as they shop to see how a Japanese mass appliance retailer is set up. This one has two basement levels, seven floors above ground, and a staggering 700,000 items on display. On this vast sales floor, all the displays and shelving rise no higher than 135 centimeters to make it easier to see what products are where. Our two customers are drawn to a display of TVs for sale. But the picture on this TV appears to be a bit blurry, doesn't it? In fact, this is a 3D TV that has just been launched. When you put on the special glasses, the images on the screen seem to pop right out at you. It really has impact. Now I want one of these too. Where are they heading next? To the refrigerator sales floor. This shop stocks more than 100 different models. They range in size from small units for those living alone to extra large ones for big families. And in the effort to be different, each manufacturer comes up with unique features for its models. This refrigerator offers vacuum storage of leftover food or raw meat and fish. It can keep food fresh longer than an ordinary fridge. And here's the world's first fridge with a mechanism to boost the vitamin content of vegetables. The secret is this lamp. Using special LEDs, it causes the stored vegetables to photosynthesize and make vitamin C. The people of Japan are renowned for their love of cleanliness. Vacuum cleaners too offer many innovations. More and more Japanese are suffering from hay fever, so there has been a parade of new models that filter out the pollen and house dust that cause allergic reactions. This item works by first wrapping a wet tissue around the cleaning head. The wet tissue wipes away particles that are too fine to be sucked up. After cleaning, the hose can be removed to turn the vacuum cleaner into an air purifier, so the appliance does double duty. Amazing! Our two customers finally make their way to the space-selling washing machines, the original reason for their shopping trip. Washing machines that double as dryers are very popular in Japan. In cramped Japanese housing, products that occupy only a small space are a must. You're looking for a washing machine? Yes. One that has a built-in dryer, deodorizes, and requires very little water. I don't mind who the manufacturer is. Shop staff are experts in the specific type of appliance they sell. Besides explaining the features of new products, they can offer finely tuned suggestions based on the shopper's budget, type of home, and so on. This washing machine uses ozone to eliminate bacteria and odors. It can sterilize items without using any water at all. It cleans suits, coats, and other garments that a conventional washing machine would ruin. And this washing machine even has a function for ironing during the drying stage. By blowing air at 360 kilometers per hour, it can de-wrinkle garments like an iron does. This machine recirculates water. It draws water from the bottom and pours it down from above. Oh, so the water comes out of the sides and is recirculated. Ah, I see. So that's how it can provide powerful washing, even though it uses less water. The two women are interested in this water-saving washing machine. Now it's down to the serious business of haggling. Manufacturers release new models of washing machines and refrigerators once a year, and it's that time of year right now. Japanese appliances undergo frequent model updates. When new models come out, there are big discounts to be had on the old ones. Sticker prices that are slashed out indicate that the item can be had for an even lower price. There is ferocious price competition among big Japanese retailers. Many purposely do not openly display prices to keep rivals in the dark about what goods are actually selling for in their stores. How low the price goes depends on the customer's haggling skills. I realize that to buy wisely, you have to read advertising flyers and do price comparisons of various stores. In Japan, both manufacturers and retailers are in a heated non-stop battle with competitors to capture consumers. That has been a major factor in Japan's transformation into a home appliances giant.
I'm actually visiting the megastore that you just saw in the video now. They sell just about every kind of electrical appliance here. Some of the most popular ones recently have been energy-saving devices. There's a twofold reason for their popularity. One is that it helps you save on your electricity bill, and the other one is it gives you a comparatively clear conscience about not contributing too much to global warming. Take, for example, this air conditioning unit behind me here. It has a built-in sensor that can tell when there's people in the room. When you're moving around, it will automatically adjust the strength of the airflow and the direction of it as well. If it senses motion, it will drop the temperature a little bit. But if you've been sitting down reading a book, for example, for a while, it will then raise it up again. In Japan, they often use the word eco, or echo as they pronounce it here, to describe energy-saving appliances. And recently, the Japanese government has introduced what they call an eco points system, whereby every time you buy an eco appliance, you get points, which you can accumulate and then trade in later for various products. There are new appliances coming onto the market constantly to meet the ever-changing needs of consumers, and keeping up with those needs requires an enormous effort on the part of both manufacturers and retailers, as we'll see in the next segment.
This is a small home appliances shop in a Tokyo suburb. You see places like this all over Japan. Each one is tied to a single major manufacturer by an exclusive distribution agreement. Shops like this exist not only to sell the manufacturer's products, but also to provide services more closely tailored to each customer. The owner of this shop, Ichiro Sekiyama, has been running it for 40 years. The local area has a lot of apartment blocks, and the residents provided a ready market for his home appliances. Japan's small retailers are known for their attentive user support. If there's any problem with something they sold, they typically send someone right over. A rising number of service calls are from customers who are having trouble figuring out how to use increasingly complex home appliances. Today, it's a woman who doesn't understand the remote control for her TV. It's so irritating, I have to go channel by channel. Simple calls like this are free of charge. Sometimes people need help urgently. When I have a problem with a product, I call the shop immediately, and they help me. I really appreciate it. I want to be like a doctor who makes house calls. That involves caring for everyone. I come right away when someone has a problem, even late at night. That's important. The manufacturer he represents has a network of around 6,000 of these small exclusive retail outlets across Japan. They provide the nuts and bolts frontline service to keep customers satisfied. Meanwhile, manufacturers continue striving to develop products that meet the wants and needs of Japanese consumers. This house was built 8 years ago for research in home appliances. The company set out to improve its understanding of how consumers feel about products by having them use items in a real living space. The findings of this research have been reflected in numerous products. This control panel is one example. Previously, these panels were black. But how does the panel look to someone with impaired vision? The company developed special goggles to find out. And they found that labels on the black panels were extremely hard to read. This control panel was made easier to use by making the colors brighter and the lettering larger. Researchers also wear clothes with weights attached as they use products, in order to replicate the experience of elderly or pregnant consumers with physical limitations. This made them aware how hard it may be for some customers to remove clothes from the bottom of vertical drum washing machines. So the company developed inclined drum machines. With these, the user can take the laundry out more easily. As might be gathered from these examples, Japanese home appliance manufacturers vie with each other in research and development aimed at creating products that are easy for everyone to use. We investigate to find out where our customers have difficulties in daily life. And we add functions that address those challenges. Here's an electric hot water pot with a communications capability built in. As Japanese society ages rapidly, the number of elderly people living alone is rising. This product was developed especially with them in mind. In the bottom of the pot is a communication device. Whenever the elderly consumer uses the pot, it sends a text message to the mobile phone of a family member, wherever he or she might be. That allows, for example, a daughter living at a distance from an elderly mother to know that she is okay without having to telephone her constantly. I know that my mother used the electric pot 15 minutes ago. It's very reassuring. Home appliances that are easy for anyone to use and put minds at ease. On both the manufacturing and retailing fronts, Japan's home appliance industry is working to meet the needs of the times.
I'm now in the city of Kawasaki, which is right next to Tokyo, and this is a museum set up by one of Japan's major home appliance makers. In this room, they have on display an array of antique appliances, some of which go all the way back to the 19th century. This is Japan's first ever refrigerator, which was made in 1930, and I'm amazed at how big it is. I can remember we had one much smaller in the early 60s when I was a kid. This, also from 1930, is Japan's first ever washing machine. And from 1 year later, 1931, Japan's first ever vacuum cleaner. After the Second World War, Japan's home appliance industry developed internationally by leaps and bounds. How did Japan manage to achieve such rapid progress? Let's take a look at the history of home appliances in Japan.
It was after the Second World War that home appliances began to spread throughout Japan. The occupying US forces wanted to impress the Japanese populace with the wonderful ways of American life. Films portraying it were shown in schools across Japan. These films revealed a prosperous lifestyle filled with the latest home appliances. But the Western-made appliances the Japanese families dreamed of owning turned out to be too large and heavy. The imports simply were not right for Japanese homes. Then along came Konosuke Matsushita. His creative ideas and innovations improved many appliances and launched new kinds of home electric and electronic goods. This is a double cluster socket that Matsushita invented. In Japan's typically cramped living quarters in the post-war years, it was common for siblings to share a room. Matsushita overheard two sisters quarreling over the use of a power socket. One of them wanted to do the ironing, the other wanted a light to read by. Clearly, some people wanted to use the same socket for different purposes at the same time. The double cluster socket that Matsushita invented became a big hit product. His company went on to develop a series of appliances suited to Japanese lifestyles. This was a compact tabletop dishwasher designed to fit small Japanese kitchens. The tabletop idea was a Japanese original. This vacuum cleaner was the first in the world to be equipped with a sensor that could detect dust and mites too small for the eye to see. Japanese consumers, with their love of cleanliness, were delighted with it. Matsushita said that business was not about what you had to do to sell products, but what you could do to give customers satisfaction and joy. Matsushita always developed products from the customer's perspective. And in doing so, his company grew into one of Japan's leading home appliance makers. In the late 1950s, when Japan's economy began to blossom, So did the Japanese love affair with home appliances. The TV, refrigerator, and washing machine became known as the three sacred treasures that every household had to own. Each of Japan's home appliance manufacturers rolled out a parade of original Japanese products with distinctive touches. This was a video cassette recorder for use at home. Compact, lightweight, and easy to transport, it quickly found widespread favor in Japan. And this was the world's first portable headphone stereo. It proved to be wildly popular, enabling people to listen to music as they rode the train to work. It was the forerunner of the portable music players that are now ubiquitous worldwide. The many home appliances resulting from improvements by Japanese manufacturers for easier use have also captured the fancy of consumers around the world.
Since ancient times, Japan has imported much of its culture from abroad, but Japanese people have a unique way of modifying the things that they bring in, and appliances are no exception to the rule. Example, what do you think this is? It's an electronic calculator from 1965, and it weighs 18 kilograms. Well, we all know what Japanese people did with electronic calculators in the ensuing years, don't we? And this television here, this one's from 1960. It's a 21-inch television. Just look at the size of that. The depth of it is about the same as the width. And, I mean, you think what a 21-inch television looks like these days. It's about that thin. There are some of these vintage appliances that are just absolutely beautiful. I was taken with this here. It's a valve radio from 1956. And even in the 1950s, they got the size down to this size. And it's got the dial for the tuner on the top. Isn't that amazing? These days, there are new models coming onto the market practically every day, but at the same time, many people feel a strong affection for vintage appliances. Next, we're going to meet a nostalgia buff and hear why.
The city of Iga in Mie Prefecture. We're here to meet an avid collector of vintage home appliances. He's the proprietor of a restaurant, Jun Tominaga. He serves up traditional Japanese fare. But where do the appliances fit in? Tominaga is one of Japan's foremost collectors of post-war home appliances. Look inside his restaurant and you'll see it's packed with fans, radios, and this stereo. All nostalgic vintage items. He's particularly proud of this black and white TV. It was made in 1960, but the picture still looks just fine. This set is special because it has a remote control, which is connected to the TV by a cord. Keep pressing the white button and it will keep changing the channels. Here's another hit product from those days. It's a filter that makes the picture on a black and white TV look just a bit as if it were in color. Tominaga collected these post-war home appliances during his years as an office worker. But he wanted to create a place with the ambience of bygone days, surrounded by vintage home appliances and electronics. So 7 years ago, he quit his job and opened this restaurant. He also keeps a lot of vintage appliances at home. His house is overflowing with electrical and electronic goods of all sorts. His collection numbers more than 7,000 items in all. He also rents a storage space near his home. Lately, he's been getting more and more calls from film and TV producers who want to use vintage appliances and electronics from his collection in dramas set in the post-war years. This is a local hotel. Part of Tominaga's collection is on display here today. Some of these items were used in filming a movie set half a century ago. These days, there's a booming nostalgia in Japan for those early post-war decades. In Japanese minds, that was when the whole country was confidently moving forward in pursuit of its ambitions. These vintage products don't have the lean and efficient designs of modern home appliances and electronics. Instead, they have that good old handcrafted feel. They came from an era when people looked to the future. And they helped people to imagine all kinds of new possibilities. For Japanese people, home appliances are not just practical objects. They also serve as mementos of the path of progress that Japan has followed.
I'm now visiting the showroom of a major home appliance manufacturer in Tokyo's Ariake district. And we're going to take a peek now at what may be the future of home appliances. This room is designed to represent the living room of the future. There's no appliances in it, but this whole wall here is one giant display screen, and it changes into all sorts of different forms. For example, there's a picture of some flowers over there on the extreme right, and that becomes a giant television screen which is within this whole display. And you can see it's now changed to an ocean view, and that will change into some other things, some sunflowers. And you'll be amazed at what's going to happen next. The whole wall turns into this vast TV display. That is really pretty impressive. It keeps changing because this is a demo set up for visitors to the showroom, but I think you get the picture of what's going on here. Now, a little bit of magic, if I can get this right, okay? And I now have a menu of different things I can do, and I'm going to choose a little video clip. Here we go. And if I get closer to the wall, the screen gets smaller. If I walk away from the wall, it enlarges. And then if I'm walking around the room like this, it actually follows me. Don't expect to see this in your local shop anytime soon, but the way that appliances have been changing in this country over the last several decades, you really never know. I'll see you again next time.
Neatly laid rows of tiles rippling across rooftops are a common sight in Japan. For centuries, ceramic roof tiles have been used in Japan to protect buildings from wind and rain. They're an essential part of everyday life. Tiled rooftops help buildings blend harmoniously into the landscape. Some roof tiles are more than just functional. They embody the wishes of those who shelter beneath. There was a time in history when roof tiles were status symbols. Some even had gold decorations. Craftsmen carry on Japan's roof tile traditions. And in recent years, new types have been developed. They include tiles with built-in solar panels. On this edition of Begin Japanology, we look at roof tiles, their contribution to Japan's traditional urban appearance, and their symbolic value in everyday life.
Hello and welcome to Begin Japanology. I'm Peter Barakan. Our theme for today is roof tiles. I'm in the city of Omi Hachiman, which is just northeast of Kyoto, and all around me you'll see these rather beautiful, muted silver-grey roof tiles, which are distinctive of this area. The tiles have been produced here for about the last 300 years. They're made with clay that comes from Lake Biwa, Japan's largest lake, which is very close by here. Roof tiles come in a variety of shapes and sizes, but the type typically used for the roofs of homes are like this, about 30 centimeters square, and they weigh about 3 kilograms. In Japan, since ancient times, houses have been built with local materials suited to the climate and conditions in each area, and that includes roof tiles as well. Even now, there are about 50 different districts around Japan that produce roof tiles, each in its local style. First of all, let's take a look at the various different types of tiles and how they fit into Japanese culture.
Roof tiles protect buildings from wind and rain. In Japan, there's a long history of tiled roofs, and they have helped to create many picturesque cityscapes. This is the city of Kawagoe in Saitama Prefecture. It retains the character of the days when it was a thriving commercial town in the 19th century. These burly, glossy, black roof tiles were preferred by the old merchant class. The Fukia district of Takahashi, a city in Okayama Prefecture. This was once a copper mining community. The streets are lined with buildings that have red tiles and walls painted red with a copper-based pigment. The buildings and tiles really stand out against the green of the surrounding mountains. Roof tiles are made of clay that is shaped and then baked. They're an essential component of traditional Japanese architecture. Roof tile making first came to Japan from the Korean Peninsula. In time, tile roofs were adopted all over Japan because they were well suited to Japan's hot, humid summers. Roof tiles are more water repellent than the alternatives, such as thatch or plank roofing. They're also very effective for blocking the sound of rain and other outside noises, so the interior environment is quieter. Tile roofs offer excellent ventilation. Gaps between the tiles and the roof allow air to pass through, so condensation does not form inside the house. Roof tiles block solar radiation very effectively. Because they're baked out of fine clay, they have excellent heat insulating properties. They're also very fire resistant, helping to protect Japan's many buildings that make heavy use of wood and paper. Tiles are a roofing material ideally suited to Japan's climate and environmental conditions. Nowadays, two main types account for most of the roof tiles used in Japan, Hongaura and Sangaura. Hongaura are heavy and impressive looking. They consist of a combination of flat and rounded tiles. They are mainly used for buildings in a traditional Japanese architectural style, such as temples and shrines. Sangaura combine Hongaura's flat and rounded elements into a single tile. This style of roof tile was developed in Japan. Lightweight, easy to install and economical. Today they're used on many Japanese houses. Roof tiles can also be categorized based on production method. These are oxidized tiles. They undergo an oxidization process at the last stage of firing, and this leaves a layer of carbon on the surface. While they absorb moisture, they repel water, so they're well suited to humid and rainy conditions. The city of Muroto in Kochi Prefecture experiences heavy rains and gales that blow in off the ocean. The city's buildings have a distinctive look. Oxidized tile roofs on top of white plastered walls. Oxidized tiles are also embedded in the walls to protect the houses from strong winds and lashing rain. These are glazed tiles. They're glazed before firing, which gives the finished surface a glassy texture. They come in many colors. Because they do not absorb water, they don't crack when ice expands in the winter months. Gotsu, a city in Shimane Prefecture, faces the Sea of Japan and experiences heavy snow each winter. This area is known for glazed tile production and its sea of red tile rooftops. Tiles made here are used in many areas of Japan that are subject to heavy snow. Here we have bisque-fired tiles. They have excellent heat insulating and air permeability properties. Taketomi Island in Okinawa Prefecture. During the summer, it experiences the blazing sun typical of Japan's southern latitudes, and also typhoons. Houses here are roofed with heat-blocking, bisque-fired red tiles. The gaps between the tiles are filled in with plaster. This prevents water infiltration and stops the tiles from being blown off in typhoon winds. Japan's regional varieties of roof tiles are well adapted to the local climate and environmental conditions. Now let's see how tiles are actually placed on a roof. There are two main methods of laying roof tiles. Here, Nishihonganji, a Buddhist temple in Kyoto, is being re-roofed. In this method, clay is used to secure the tiles to the roof. Clay is piled up at the intersections of roof framing members to create an appropriate surface for laying the lines of roof tiles as you wish. But clay makes a roof very heavy and is very labor intensive, so this method is rarely used except for religious structures. These days, this method is more common. Roof tiles are nailed to cross pieces attached to the roof framing. Because no clay is used, the roof is lighter. It can be completed more quickly and with less effort. Roof tiles which came to Japan in ancient times from the Korean Peninsula underwent many improvements as they were adapted to Japan's climate and environmental conditions. And now they're an essential element of Japanese architecture.
Behind me here is a factory in Omihachiman that makes roof tiles in the local style. They're actually named after the place as well. They're called Hachiman Gawara. Let's go in and take a look. Standing with me here is the last remaining roof tile craftsman in Omihachiman. His name is Yasuo Tabuchi, and he makes these oxidized roof tiles. Can I ask him a little bit about his work? Can you explain to me what it is you're doing actually?
See over here? This is a finished product, and I'm making another one like it. These decorative tiles are for the ends of the ridge of a roof.
What's the most difficult part about this work?
They're ceramic, so they warp when you fire them. The moisture content varies depending on the time of year, so you take all that into account and warp them in the opposite direction before firing. What's difficult is making them come out all flat in the end.
As you can see, tile making has been elevated to quite an art form in Japan, but it took a long time for tiles to penetrate throughout the country. Let's look back at the history now.
In ancient times, Nara was the capital of Japan. This is the Gokurakudo, a part of the Buddhist temple Gangoji. It's a national treasure. The reddish tiles of the roof are the oldest ones in existence in Japan. The technique of laying roof tiles came to Japan from the Korean peninsula towards the end of the 6th century, just around the time when Japan's first temples were being built. The roof tiles of Gangoji are believed to have been made at around that time. They have sheltered the Gokurakudo for 1,400 years. Roof tiles are closely associated with the transmission of Buddhism to Japan. These tiles were used in temples in the late 7th century. Inscribed on them are lotus flowers, a symbol of the Buddha. It's said they embodied the wish that Buddhism would spread throughout Japan. For a long time after that, roof tiles were used mainly in the building of Buddhist temples across Japan. These paintings show 16th century Kyoto. The houses of the townsfolk at that time had plank or thatch roofs. Because roof tiles were extremely expensive, they were out of reach for ordinary people. On the other hand, for the warrior class, roof tiles came to possess a special significance. Contending warlords sought ways to show off their might. Oda Nobunaga, who set out to unify Japan, built a massive castle as a symbol of his power. This is a reconstruction of the enormous and ornate donjon of Azuchi Castle. Nobunaga made lavish use of expensive roof tiles to decorate this palatial fortress. Here's a roof tile from Azuchi Castle. It's an oxidized tile decorated with lacquer and gold leaf. Following this, warlords competed to have the showiest tile-roofed castles, visibly trumpeting their power. The use of roof tiles began to spread among ordinary people in the 18th century under the shogun Tokugawa Yoshimune, who encouraged the use of tile roofing in 1720. At the time, the population of Tokyo, then known as Edo, was rapidly growing and the city had a high density of houses. Most houses were made of wood, so whenever a fire broke out, it could easily develop into a massive conflagration. Roof tiles were highly fire resistant and were thus adopted as a fire prevention measure. One key factor behind the widespread use of tiled roofs was the invention of a new type of tile, sangawa. These tiles were lightweight, easy to install, and less than half the cost of previous ones. They accelerated the use of tiles for ordinary homes. Tiles evolved over a millennium and eventually became deeply ingrained in Japanese architecture.
In this idyllic setting and just by a moat which in the olden days used to be used to transport tiles, we have a museum here which is dedicated to roof tiles. They have tiles here on display from all over Japan and indeed from around the world as well. Let's go in and take a look. With the westernization of Japanese homes starting in the second half of the 19th century, a number of influences, mainly from Europe, also came in as well. For example, we have here what's called a French tile, although this one was actually made in Japan. And this is a Spanish style, alternating, one going up and the other going down. And this was adapted in Japan so that, although this was originally taken from a Spanish style. In addition to the various imported forms, there are a number of types of decorative Japanese tiles that are still being produced. For example, this one here was used in a church, as you can tell from its crucifix design. Decorative tiles tend to have special significance. Let's take a look at a few now.
Roof tiles have been used in Japanese architecture for more than a millennium. They have also served as a medium for intricate decorative designs. Especially famous among Japanese decorative roof tiles are the gargoyles that adorn roof ends. These tiles originally helped to stop rain from getting under the roof. In time, they began to be carved with fearsome gargoyle designs to ward off evil. Kofukuji, a temple in Nara Prefecture. The gargoyle tiles here have sharp horns and glaring eyes. The belief was that such frightening expressions would keep evil spirits away. Although gargoyles are demons, they're also closely associated with everyday life in Japan. By staying on good terms with them, people sought to win their support in warding off disaster. In urban areas where houses were closely packed, it was considered rude to have a gargoyle staring directly at a neighbor's house. So instead, the image of the Chinese deity Shorki, vanquisher of demons, was used. People usually put their Shorki tiles above the main entrance to their houses and have them face out onto the street to prevent disaster from coming inside. But if the house across the street has a Shorki tile, you must carefully position your own Shorki to avoid having them stare at each other. Neighborly consideration is needed even in matters of warding off evil. Back to the island of Taketomi in Okinawa. The decorative roof tiles here are a bit different. A legendary lion-like beast protects Okinawans from evil. Typhoons and storms are frequent here, so many houses have these magical lion creatures on the roof to keep disaster away. Decorative roof tiles can also embody many other hopes and wishes. The Japanese kanji character for water is shown on this tile. The idea is that it will protect the building from fire. At each end of this roof is a mythical sea creature with the body of a fish and the head of a tiger. These supernatural beings are said to spout water in order to douse fires. So, in Japan, roof tiles are made in their shape. Who is this smiling figure on the roof of a shop? The god of good fortune, Ebisu. He is the patron of commerce and is believed to bring success in business. Here we have a family crest along with crane and turtle motifs. In Japan, these are symbols of longevity. It's said that the crane lives 1,000 years and the turtle 10,000 years. These roof tiles express the wish that the family line will flourish in perpetuity. From ancient times, many Japanese people have lived sedentary agricultural lives. So a house was a major asset, and the roof guarded the house against the elements. By affixing decorative tiles to the roof, people sought to protect the house and the family who lived in it.
Here we have some more examples of decorative tiles. For example, this one here is a chrysanthemum motif. There's also a wave pattern here, and the water would be connected to fire prevention. And here we have a dragon The dragon goes up into the heavens and creates clouds, which then make rainfall. Of course, rain is always something that's needed by people in rural areas for agriculture. As a result of the recent global economic recession, the tile-making industry in Japan has been pretty badly hit, but there are new types of tiles being made as well. Next, we'll take a look at some of those.
The city of Takahama in Aichi Prefecture is Japan's leading center of roof tile production. One tile-making company here has been developing products with an eco-friendly angle. We want to make a roof tile that will appeal to women. That means an environmentally conscious roof tile. They turn their attention to moss. In the middle of the tile is netting with moss embedded in it. When watered, the moss absorbs the moisture and turns a vibrant green right before your eyes. Moss has around 20 times the water retention capacity of soil. Used on roof tiles, it should help to reduce the heat island effect in urban areas. Hojo, a city in Ehime Prefecture. This maker of oxidized roof tiles has developed disaster-resistant products. These are standard roof tiles. And these are the company's newly developed ones. At first glance, they don't look very different. But when they're slid apart, you can see that the new tiles have a triangular tab. This little tab helps to lock the roof tiles together so that they can better resist typhoons and earthquakes. Roof tiles of this area have always been about beauty alone. We wanted to go beyond that, so we set out to make a disaster-resistant tile. In tests, these roof tiles have been shown to withstand earthquakes of the maximum intensity on the Japanese scale, and wind speeds of up to about 165 kilometers per hour. Beautiful, traditional Japanese roof tiles are evolving in even more radical ways. Hamada City in Shimane Prefecture is known for a particular style of roof tile. Now a manufacturer here has developed tiles with built-in solar panels. The goal was to update roof tiles to suit contemporary requirements. Solar power generation is expected to keep growing. We hope consumers will use our tiles as part of that trend, and we hope to contribute to the greater success of tiles in this area. The selling point of this product is that there is a seamless transition between the panels and the rest of the roof tiles. From a design standpoint, it's much more appealing than just attaching separate solar panels to the roof. Roof tiles have sheltered Japanese buildings for many centuries. They continue to evolve in form and function to meet the needs of each era.
Roof tiles are made out of ecologically sound material. Old ones can be remade into new ones, or they can be ground up and used for paving. This walking path here is all made out of discarded old tiles. And the powdery substance between the tile parts is also made out of pulverized old tiles. Of course, it's extremely porous and holds water very well. So the water that it's absorbed during rainy weather is then released as vapor during dry weather. And the surface temperature can be reduced by as much as 10 degrees Celsius during the hot summer months. Recently, Japan's tile makers have been using their ingenuity to come up with new products. For example, this one's made out of glass and can be used for a skylight. Pretty neat. I'll see you again next time.